Morning, everyone. It's now 9:02, and we still have people joining the webinar. But I think we can start already. Welcome, everyone, to the Greener Hub webinar series. My name is Evelyn Zuniga, and I am one of the communications officers for the Greener Hub project. For those of you who are new in the webinar series, the Greener Hub officially started in September 2022 as a coordination and support action of the European Commission under the Horizon Europe program, and it currently represents 15 ARNETs, co-funds, and self-sustained initiatives in the field of agri-food and biotechnology. We started this breakfast series last year in October, where our first series was focused on circularity in agriculture. And so if you're interested in topics related to mixed farming system, mitigation of greenhouse gas emissions, sustainable farming, and circular food systems, all our recordings are now available in YouTube. And now, and for these 3 months, we changed our focus. Our second series, it's about biotechnology to advance sustainable solutions for bioeconomy. And here we have been talking about topics related to plastic degradation, production of chemicals in a sustainable way, biofuel production, protein engineering, among others. I just want to give a few housekeeping announcements. Feel free to type your questions in the Q&A box and the chat section that I have activated for everyone. I am going to do my best to address as many as possible with the time that we have, which is 1 hour. And if at the end of the session you have a question for either of the speakers and we still have time, you can address the speaker in each question. Today, we will have two panelists, Dr. Cristina Gonzalez and Dr. Heike Sträuber. And we are going to open our presentations with Dr. Cristina Gonzalez. Dr. Cristina is a senior researcher and head of the Biotechnological Process Unit at IMDEA Energy in Spain. Her research interests are focused towards the production of biofuels and bioproducts to the development of biological processes using residual substrates and different microorganisms. And her research lines also include the use of microalgae in upstream and downstream processes for wastewater treatment, as well as the production of microbial oils in lignocellulosic biofuels and bioproducts. Today, the title of her talk is Sustainable Oleochemicals, Bioproduction from Carboxylates via Oleaginous Fermentation, which is part of the Oleoferm project from the Eraco Biotech ERANET. Dr. Cristina, thank you very much for joining us today and for accepting this invitation to present like insights on your project. And what I'm going to do now is stop sharing my screen so you can start sharing your presentation with us. Thank you so much.
Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes. Yes, perfect.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. And yes, this is a project from the Eraco Biotech, and what we are targeting at is the oleochemical bioproduction from carboxylates. And for this, we use oleaginous fermentation. Wait, I'm going to move this. Okay. So what we know is that we have the market of oleochemicals that keeps on increasing the demand, and that the alternative to petrochemicals are the vegetable oils and animal fats. But this is limited to some regions in the world. And in fact, in Europe, we don't have much of these types of oils sources. So what we wanted was to find an alternative source of oils, and we thought about microbial oils, more particularly about yeasts that accumulate oil. This would give us the chance of having oils everywhere, not just, for instance, vegetable oils that comes from Asia. And because we use yeast, we don't have climatologic dependence, such is the case of microalgae that depends on sunny weather and sunny high temperatures. And also, if we compare microalgae and yeast, yeast are better because they grow at high density and they have higher growth rates. So we select yeast, but the problem with yeast is that they mainly use as carbon source sugars, glucose and xylose. And this is limited to certain substrates, mostly lignocellulosic material. And when you want to get glucose, for instance, from lignocellulosic material, you need some pretreatment, some hydrolysis, and we wanted to avoid that. So instead of using sugars for the yeast, we propose an alternative carbon source, which are short-chain fatty acids. And this carbon source is produced in similar to an anaerobic digestion process, that is what you have on your right. So you can use any type of organic waste, no matter the distribution of molecules. You can have waste rich in proteins or carbohydrates or whatever. And it goes through four different degradation stages. And in principle, when you go to anaerobic digestion, you will get biogas at the end. So this mixture of methane and CO2. But what we do is to stop the digestion in just the fermenting stages. So we accumulate these short-chain fatty acids that we use later on to feed our oleaginous yeast. So our carbon source is, instead of sugars, we use from acetic to hexanoic acids. So what do we know about this type of oleaginous yeast? Mostly they use glucose, as I mentioned, and we know that then it goes in the de novo route. And if you use a carbon source that is not soluble in water, like a fatty acid, it goes in the ex novo route for lipid production. But this is pretty relevant because they have a high dependency, also depending on which pathway the carbon source follows, because it depends on nitrogen in the cultivation medium also. So what happened with short-chain fatty acids? This is not known yet, because acetic would be more like a glucose, but hexanoic would be more in the other side. So this project is including five partners that you have over here. We are at IMDEA Energy in Madrid, Spain. And then we have two French partners, Université Clermont-Auvergne and the private company BioValo. And then two partners from Slovenia, Joseph, from the Joseph Stefan Institute and the University of Ljubljana. So five partners coming from three different countries, a total budget of 1 million more or less. We started in 2021 and we got an extension, and it will be finished in a couple of months. So the idea of what we do in Oleoferm is to interconnect two bioprocesses. The first one is anaerobic fermentation, and the second one, the oleaginous fermentation. In the first one, we use organic waste. We subject this organic waste to anaerobic fermentation. We produce our innovative carbon source, which is this short-chain fatty acid, and we feed the organic, the oleaginous yeast that accumulate microbial oils that can be used in the oleochemical industry. So I'm going to show you just some small, few data that we have in the two bioprocesses. So in the first one, the anaerobic fermentation, excuse me, we start with, we always work with real waste. So this means in this case, we have food waste. And here you have the characterization. In this case, we have a material that is rich in carbohydrates and organic matter that is mostly particulate. So we have a lot of organic matter, but not in the soluble form. So we run our controls to produce short-chain fatty acids, which is this box that you have on top, with the common conditions that we have highlighted here. And then we also see how the systems react to upon perturbation. So we have conducted several of them. So we have checked what happened when you have the system starving, or you don't control the pH. And also we check what happened when the temperature is not set at 25 degrees, which is the one that is optimum for short-chain fatty acid production. So we decreased the temperature to 20 degrees, 15, and we went one step farther. And instead of just subjecting these perturbations for 15 days, in this case, decreasing the temperature to 15 degrees, we hold this temperature for 45 days to see what happens. We don't only check what happened upon perturbation, but we also check how we can recover those systems. So I have included here some data for you to see what kind of data we get. So you can see here the metabolites production. This means our carbon sources, the short-chain fatty acids. And here you have what we get when we have our conventional conditions. We get a bioconversion of more or less 45%. This means the organic matter that we feed into the anaerobic system, how much we convert to short-chain fatty acids. So more or less half of the organic matter is converted into short-chain fatty acids. What happened when we decrease the temperature from 25 to 20 degrees is that we get a small, a really slight decrease in the bioconversion. But when we set up again 25 degrees, the systems recover and we get back to our initial bioconversion. So this means that this perturbation of 20 degrees is not really affecting the process. But we went a little bit lower in temperature and we checked 15 degrees perturbation. And what we got was that from our conventional values, having exhibiting 45% bioconversion, when the reactor is subjected to 15 degrees, the bioconversion goes to 36%, and we are starting to accumulate some chemicals that were not present there before. So we start having succinic acid, for instance. But again, when we get back the reactor to 25 degrees, the systems recover easily in a few days, and we get again our 45% bioconversion. This would be if we subject the system to a lower temperature for 15 days. But what happens if we decrease the temperature and we hold this perturbation for 45 days? Here, the system gets really unstable, as you can see. So we were in the black dots, around 40% bioconversion. And when you hold the temperature at 15 degrees, the bioconversion goes down, really below 10, but we have even what we have is some warning indicators that the system is going wrong also, not just succinic acid like before that you have here in the violet bar. We also have an accumulation of ethanol in the cultivation broth and a really high concentration of lactic acid going to approximately 15 grams per liter. So again, we see that at 15 degrees, the process, yes, it does really have an effect. The bioconversion goes really down, but we put again the system at 25 degrees and it recovers a little bit lower than at the initial, at the conventional values. And what we also saw is these new indicators that the system is collapsing. Yeah, so now we have, this was an example of our short-chain fatty acids, what kind of concentration we can get and what kind of profiles we get. So we want to feed these short-chain fatty acids into the second oleaginous fermentation, our second bioprocess, to accumulate lipids in this case. So we did screening of oleaginous yeast. Our Slovenian partners, they screen 1,000 yeasts, and they try two different concentrations, 15 grams per liter and 25. As you saw before, more or less we are getting 25 grams of short-chain fatty acids in the anaerobic fermentation. So this would be our top level. And then it's also really important what kind of short-chain fatty acids you are having in this feeding. So we use more acetic than the rest of the short chain fatty acids because this is the smaller molecule, and this means that it's going to be easily uptaken by the yeast. So the results show that PKA gave good results also, but we stay with Jarrobiali politica to continue our work. So as I mentioned before, nitrogen is important when it comes to yeast and the growth of yeast to accumulate lipids. But it's not only about what we saw, it was that it was not only about nitrogen, but also phosphate. Phosphate was shown to be pretty relevant depending on the concentration of short chain fatty acids that you are using. Here you can see that the higher you go in the short chain fatty acids, the higher concentration you use, the effect of phosphate would be more important. For instance, if you have 10 grams of phosphate in your fermentation, together with 15 grams of short chain fatty acids, this would mean a total inhibition of the process. Not only, we don't only check the growth and the and how much of these short chain fatty acids are being consumed. Of course, we also check how much lipids are produced. And what we saw is that if we don't have phosphate in the medium, this would be also good for oil accumulation because we can reach 45% of lipids in the yeast. We were also pretty happy about the results we got because our lipid yields, this means how much lipids we are accumulating per gram of carbon source that is being consumed, were pretty high, were 0.3, which is similar of the values that you get when you use sugars as a carbon source. So we are using an alternative carbon source, but we are reaching the same yields as with sugars. So just to finish, what we saw in this project is that we can produce efficiently a carbon source different than sugars. We can convert waste into short-chain fatty acids at a bioconversion efficiency of approximately 50%. That the process is pretty robust, even if some perturbations are taking place. We saw that our best candidate to produce oils is Jarrobiali politica. We have identified which are the short-chain fatty acids that they prefer and which is the concentration of short-chain fatty acids that we should not go above. And we have also evidence that is not only about nitrogen, but also about phosphate that you have in your cultivation media, and that we can reach the same yields with carbon, with this short chain fatty acid than the values you can attain with sugars. And there at the bottom, you have the website of the project and my contact just in case you want to make some comments or questions or whatever you need. And that's it with my presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gonzalez, for a very insightful presentation. I want to remind people, although there are some people already putting questions, you can put your questions in the Q&A section, and I'm going to read one of them. It says, which microorganisms were used in anaerobic fermentation and from where they were obtained? That's one of the questions.
We normally use, we start, our inoculum comes from wastewater treatment plants, the anaerobic digester. So we take advantage there that we have a lot of activities. It's an open microbiome in which you have a little bit of everything. And then when we set our restricting conditions in the fermentation, we get the strain, the general that we want prevailing in the system. But our source of microorganisms come from wastewater treatment plants.
Okay, and there's a second question, but I think you already mentioned that. It says, how was the productivity of oils in comparison with a process using sugars?
Yeah, the yields until now, we are at the same level. So this is pretty good. We are pretty happy with this.
Okay, I have a question about, so what kind of pretreatment do you need for the organic waste that you used for the production of short chain fatty acid? Like, do you need to dry them? Do you need to like do some kind of acid treatment or something?
Nothing, we just blend it. Blend
Really,
it
just blend.
sugar,
That's amazing.
And that's it, and it goes directly into the fermenter.
Okay, that's fantastic because many of those processes also require a lot of energy.
Yeah, but in
Yeah.
this case, it's that's also if you use some kind of lignocellulose material, yes, you need more treatment, more hydrolysis, and in this
Yeah.
case, it goes with the food waste is easier.
Okay. And it can be any food waste.
In principle, we prefer if they have if the mixture have more carbohydrates.
Oh, okay, some more sugary kind of things.
Yes.
Okay. And there's another question here. It says the oils are produced intracellularly or extracellularly or extracellularly. What does the DSP look like?
It's intracellular, and the characterization that we have conducted into these oils that are being accumulated is that it really looks like vegetable oil. So it's mostly C16 and C18. So this is also good to be used in the oleochemical chemistry sector.
Okay, it says another one. How much titers are achieved at the end of the fermentation?
In which one? In the anaerobic fermentation, it's we are having like 25 grams per liter of short-chain fatty acids. And in the oleaginous fermentation, for us, it's not so much about, it's not the concentration that you need to check because you have your biomass and then you have to check what you have intracellularly. So it's a trade-off in between.
Okay. I have another question here. So I was wondering like how do you predict it might be the main difficulties for moving the system? Like are you already in a bioreactor kind of scale? Like are you like in a longer scale or
Yeah, for the anaerobic fermentation, for the first stage,
yeah, for the first part.
yeah, in this project in Oleoferm, I didn't show, but we scale up the system in the private company that is also participating with BioValo. And we have upscaled the system, the anaerobic fermentation, to 250 liters.
Okay.
And we got also pretty good results, similar to what we got in the lab. So the system can be upscaled without diminishing your bioconversion efficiency. And regarding the oleaginous fermentation, this is at a lower TRL. We are still moving from batch assays to continuous or semi-continuous operated small reactors. We are operating reactors of 1 liter.
Okay, it seems like according to the experiments that you did with the temperature, it seems like a pretty stable system of fermentation.
Yeah, and the thing is that it's also a low temperature always. So 25 degrees, you don't need to put a lot of energy in heating the bioreactors or something.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's true. And so I have a question. So you decided to stay with Yarovia to do the process, the second part of the process. And do you have like, are you testing different strains of Yarovia, or there is like a type strain that accumulates very good, and then you use that one, and maybe you can, I don't know if you're doing like genetic modifications on that strain, but or you
We
just
have
use.
used two or three Yarovia hippolytica, different, but and they behave kind of similar. They have I'm saying kind of, they have some slight differences. And yes, we stick with Yarovia because we know the genome, and just in case we need to do something with it, we know that the information is ready.
Okay, that's perfect. This is a different question. Like it's not more about the science. I'm just curious about to know how was for you the experience of coordinating a project, like a transnational project with partners in different countries and then sometimes with difference in in time zones, like how has been the experience? Like, what is your strategy for like the young researchers who are looking this webinar now, and like what kind of are the tips that you could maybe?
It's an interesting question for me because we wrote this project proposal when we were locked at home with the COVID. So we were meeting our partners online for the first time.
Yeah.
And this is also, it's an experience that is different to what you are used to. We were looking for our partners, but without knowing them, and the only contact with them was online. So you go write your proposal, you get your project, and you are still not really being able to travel for the meetings and everything. So it was a weird situation for this project, but at the end, I think we got even like this in this situation, we are getting really nice results.
Yeah,
and it's totally worth it that we applied for this funding to Eraco Biotech, and that we are about to finish the project, and we got a really nice result. So it's a totally satisfactory experience for me.
Okay, and so how do you find this the experience of contacting these partners, and like are they kind of always like willing to join the project, or is there like how do you hook people to wanted to join projects like this?
I think when you propose someone to join, it's mostly your answer. The answer you get is yes, because it's always nice that someone knocks at your door to tell you, I like what you are doing and I want you in my project. Then it's also true that because with COVID, we started to be to get really familiar with online meetings. This is also good in a way that you don't need to travel to share your results and everything like before. But sometimes it's also true that I miss a little bit of the face-to-face interaction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So this is something that I think we are abusing a little bit now.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting to hear from a young researcher like how kind of you can look for interactions and network to create a project of this magnitude that you actually have right now. So I think we can move on now to the next presentation. Thank you very much, Cristina, for your presentation. It's amazing. We have more questions, but maybe at the end I'll have time to answer.
Okay.
You can, if you want, you can type answers to the questions that are there. Like, there's no problem. You can go ahead and do that. Thank you very much, Cristina, for joining.
Thank you.
And now maybe if you can stop sharing the screen so Dr. Heike can start. Thank you. Okay. And next we have Dr. Heike Sträuber, who is currently a senior scientist at the Helmholtz Center for Environmental Research at the Department of Microbial Biotechnology. And let me share 1 second my screen here. Dr. Sträuber, her work focuses on gaining a deeper understanding of the microbial relationships and activities in the anaerobic fermentation process, aiming at higher efficiencies of processes for the production of carboxylate platform chemicals, for example, short and medium chain fatty acids for methane or methane from biomass. Also the microbial chain elongation with lactic acid and ethanol, as well as the combination with syngas fermentation and metabolic fluxes between microorganisms are among her research interests. Today, Dr. Sträuber's talk is entitled Engineering Microbial Communities for the Conversion of Lignocellulose into Medium Chain Carboxylates. Thank you very much, Dr. Sträuber, for joining us today and giving us insights on your project from the Eraco. Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention that The project is called Cell for Chem and is part of the ERCO Biotech initiative. Thank you very much, Dr. Sträuber. So I'm just going to stop sharing my screen so you can start sharing your screen and giving us your presentation. Thank you so much. Okay, perfect.
Okay, so then I will share my screen and I hope it works well now and it's visible.
Yes, perfect.
Okay.
It's visible.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. And it's my pleasure to present today the Cell for Chem project. It's about the engineering of microbial communities for the conversion of lignocellulose into medium chain carboxylates. And we have already heard a lot about biomass today. So I will also talk about organic waste and residues, and biomass has a quite complex chemical composition. And one of the state-of-the-art technologies, of the major technologies to treat organic waste nowadays, is the anaerobic digestion process. And this is for providing energy carriers such as biogas and biomethane. And the biomass is composed mainly of proteins, carbohydrates, and lipids, and also in many other biomolecules. And as complex is also the anaerobic digestion process. We can we have already heard about it today. This is can be separated into the four metabolic steps: hydrolysis, acidogenesis, acetogenesis, and methanogenesis. And this process harbors not only the potential for production of energy carriers, but also for the production of green chemicals, such as, for instance, isobutyrate, isovalerate, which are branched-chain carboxylates, ethanol and propanol, for instance, for the alcohol groups, can be produced. We are mostly interested in carboxylates, such as short-chain carboxylates. We define them as a carbon chain with a carbon chain length from 2, 3, and 4 carbon atoms. So that means acetate, propionate, butyrate. Also, lactate is interesting for us. And our major interest is in the microbial chain elongation, because this is a possibility to produce medium chain carboxylates from the short chain carboxylates, and these medium chain carboxylates have a higher value. And but for this reaction, we need an electron donors. This could be, for instance, ethanol or lactate. And when we run the process in that way, that the chemicals are in the focus and are the main products, then we are on the carboxylate platform. And this is an option or a possibility to have a more sustainable production of these medium chain carboxylates compared to the way how it is done nowadays, because nowadays they are produced from fossil resources or palm oil. So these medium chain carboxylates we focus on, we are mostly interested in the caprolate, which has 6 C atoms, and caprolate with 8 C atoms. And they can, for instance, be directly used as feed additives, because they have a beneficial effect on the intestinal health of livestock. But more often they are also converted to derivatives, and often to esters, for instance, and then they can be used in lubricants or for plasticizers and coatings or in detergents, but also higher value markets such as pharmaceuticals or cosmetics. Also in these markets, they can be applied and used. And even in very high volume markets, such as bioplastics and aviation fuels, also these markets can be reached with these compounds. So the applicability of this carboxylate platform is limited due to the demand on the chemical structure of these substrates. And we want to extend this applicability and the substrate range, and this we do in the CellforChem project because the lignocellulose is a highly abundant feedstock, and therefore we want to use this also, apply this also for this platform. But the problem with lignocellulose is that the microbial hydrolysis of this substrate is really slow, and also the electron donor that is needed for the microbial chain elongation, its production is insufficient in the process. And therefore, if you would, for instance, ferment straw in such a process, then mainly short-chain carboxylates such as acetate, propionate, and butyrate are the main products. And this we want to change, and therefore our strategy in the CellforChem project is that we work with constructed defined mixed cultures from where we use bacterial specialists that could be also genetically modified organisms, and we need a tailor-made process engineering which can tackle with the specific properties of the lignocellulose. So I will shortly introduce the project consortium. Besides me, I am working at the Helmholtz Center for Environmental Research in Leipzig. We have project partners, and these are Professor Aleš Berlitz from the Joseph Stefan Institute in Ljubljana, Dr. Stephanie Piret from the CNRS LCB in Marseille, Professor Daniel Machado from the Norwegian University of Science and Technology in Trondheim, and Professor Marta Caballa from the University of Santiago de Compostela. And we have also one company, and this is the Blue Metano in Berlin. So some more details about the strategy that we follow in the CellforChem project. The bottlenecks, cellulose hydrolysis and lactate production are being addressed in this strategy. So we work with lactate producing and cellulolytic and xylenolytic bacteria strains, and they are modified in a way that they are able to cleave cellulose, and this is the challenge lies in the secretion of the cellulases because they are extracellular enzymes, and they are need to form cellulosomes, big enzyme complexes that then can break down the cellulose fibers to simple sugars. So these and from these sugars, then lactate is produced. And later on, we use these GMOs in the constructed consortia and combine them with other bacteria, bacterial strains, and also with other cultures. And we create consortia with and without GMOs and compare their performance in the end. We are interested in the community dynamics during product formation. And at the beginning, we work with artificial substrates such as cellulose and hemicellulose. And later on, we want to test also our cultures on real biomass. And in this case, we use straw as a model substrate. And we are interested in the community functions. And therefore, we are also working on metabolic modeling of this consortium. And in the third part, We are interested in the best operational strategies for steering the anaerobic fermentation because there are many side reactions. That is, for instance, in at least in this project, we are not interested in the odd-numbered carboxylates, and we try to avoid formation of these side products. And the aim is to steer the direction really towards the MCC production. Also in this more complex systems, we follow the community dynamics, and in the end, it's the aim to upscale our constructed consortia to reactor scale. So here you see a simplified metabolic scheme of the fermentation system. We have on top the cellulose and hemicellulose, These are the fermentable parts of the lignocellulose. Lignocellulose hydrolyzing bacteria are cleaving and degrading these fiber compounds to cellobiose, glucose, xylose, and other sugars. And the glucose can then be used by lactic acid bacteria to produce lactate. And the other sugars and also glucose is used by the lignocellulose hydrolyzing bacteria to produce acetate and acetate and butyrate. So the size of the arrows show actually or demonstrate the desired pathways. The bigger the size, the more desired this way is. So, and in the end, we have the third step. We have the microbial chain elongation where lactate and acetate and butyrate are used for the production of caprate. So we need at least these three metabolic groups in our consortia. And yeah, the question is what sources we use for obtaining the right organisms. And for this, we have enriched cultures on crystalline and amorphous cellulose and on xylene to enrich the right function, particularly those of the fiber hydrolysis. Then we combine them with pure cultures. There we have the already mentioned GMOs and also wild type strains, which belong to the three functional groups. So we started with the enrichment of the cultures, and there you can see one example. We have, for instance, we have enriched cultures from compost and digestate, but we used also, for instance, cow manure as one source or marshland soil. And these cultures from compost and digestate really performed well. Here we see the xylene degrading culture. It was enriched to have, to a really low diversity. In the end, we have only three families enriched. These are the Rhominococcaceae, the Lachnospiraceae, and the Sulfovibrionaceae. And then after this enrichment, we did a screening. We have screened at the beginning 20 strain combinations without GMOs, but included enrichment cultures, and checked how well they were able to produce our target product caprate. And here you see one example of one promising enrichment culture. This is not of the enrichment culture, but of such a constructed consortium. It includes the enrichment culture from the left-hand side, but also other bacteria, lactic acid bacteria and chain elongating bacteria were added. And then you see that lactate was produced in the first few days and consumed afterwards. That means lactic acid production already worked. And caprate, was our target product was produced, and also even more produced when lactate was consumed. And in this culture, cellulose and xylene were the only substrates. And after this screening with this only wild type systems, we had another screening where we included the GMOs, and now we are comparing the performances of these cultures. So the winner cultures were then subjected or are then will be subjected to further experiments where with the target of a proportional growth of during the cultivation in small and reactor scale. We follow the metabolism by, for instance, by HPLC. We measure the concentrations of our products, and we also check or measure how the substrates are consumed. The most promising cultures will then be further characterized and optimized. For instance, we investigate them in terms of their dependency on pH, but also nutrient scale, of course, and also, for instance, things like ratios of the substrates and so on. I already mentioned we will then test our most promising systems on a real feedstock, on a real straw. And we are interested in the community structure and dynamics of these cultures. We may analyze them by amplicon sequencing and create also metabolic models. We are, of course, interested in the question if the GMOs can establish in these consortia or if they will be outcompeted by wild-type strains. And we are also interested in the metabolic potential of the more complex systems, such as the enrichment cultures. So we analyze them by metagenomics and metaproteomics to find out who are the key players in these systems, what are their functions, and how do they cooperate with each other, or are there some competition and so on. And we are also interested, we model the individual strains, and also genome scale metabolic modeling is done with the consortia. So, and with this, I would like to thank you for your attention. I would like to invite you to follow us on LinkedIn or to visit our website, which is regularly updated with news from the project. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Heike, for a fantastic presentation. And I already have questions coming here. the first one says, can you please go through the methodology of enrichment of anaerobic cellulolytic and silanolytic cultures?
Yes. We work with the Hungate technique. So it's a classical anaerobic cultivation technique, where we work in serum bottles, or we have such serum. I can maybe show, I have had one picture. Yeah, there's one. So you see the serum bottles?
Yeah.
These. Mm-hmm. And there we started with a small amount of inoculum. So it was marshland soil or cow manure or digestate and compost sample. And we added a mineral medium, and as substrates we used either amorphous or crystalline or cellulose or xylene, and then they are incubated for some time in an incubator, so at I think 38 degrees or 35, I'm not, no, 33 degrees as far as I remember, and then we regularly transfer them, so we need to, we take a small small amount of one bottle and put it into a new bottle with a fresh substrate, fresh medium, and this we do several times, and after 10 to, we did this 10 to 13 times, and then there's no material from the inoculum left anymore, but just the microorganisms are enriched that can grow under these conditions and use these substrates.
Okay, great. We have another one here. It says, which genetic modifications were performed to construct the new consortia?
Which genetic modification? Yeah. Actually, I cannot say much about this because this was done by our project partners. And
confidential.
Yes, it's partly confidential, and also the strains, I don't want to mention them. Okay. There were lactic acid bacteria, lactic acid strains, lactic acid bacteria were used, and also one strain with cellulolytic and xylanolytic properties.
Okay, perfect. Says, what was the pH for fermentation? What was the pH for fermentation to limit the formation of odd chain fatty acids?
This was done by our Spanish partners. They investigated the effect of pH on the fermentation. They did this in reactor scale and worked with complex systems. And they investigated how the pH influenced the product spectrum. And they tested, as far as I remember, different pHs, 4.5, 5 and 5.0 and 6 or 6.0. And their aim was to increase the share of even numbered carboxylates, which is then needed also for after chain elongation to produce caproate from, for instance, from butyrate. As far as I know, I mean, this has an effect. pHs below 5 are often difficult in anaerobic fermentation, because often also only lactic acid bacteria can survive these low pHs, and then just lactic acid is produced. At higher pHs, this is, yeah, I think it's not so, maybe not so important. Yeah, it is important to pHs, but the pH more influences the, for instance, cellulose hydrolysis, because this is often inhibited at lower pH, so below neutral pH. And but I think the share of odd-numbered carboxylates is more influenced by the inoculum. If you have the right bacteria in the inoculum or present that are able to produce, for instance, propionate and then elongated to valerate, then this will happen. So, and this is often the case, for instance, in wastewater treatment systems. When you go more to agricultural biogas plants, then often propionate is not that present, and at lower pHs, yeah, I'm not sure if the another pH influences really the share of odd or even numbered carboxylates.
Okay, and we have a question here. It says, can we go beyond ethanol formation so ethanol can be further transformed or not?
Yes, ethanol is one product of the anaerobic fermentation, and this can be used as electron donor for the production of medium chain carboxylates. So besides lactate that we focus on in the CellForChem project, also ethanol is quite well suitable for chain elongation. Okay. So ethanol is usually a product from, for instance, from anaerobic fermentation with yeasts, but also in the bacterial anaerobic fermentation, it appears and it's formed. But this can directly be used then, for instance, for chain elongation.
Okay. Somebody's asking, any plans to incorporate other gene editing technologies such as CRISPR in addition to synthetic biology approach?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Any plans to incorporate other gene editing technologies such as CRISPR in addition to
synthetic? Yeah, this also goes into the direction of the genetic works. So actually, I don't know. But as far as I'm not sure, so I would say, but as far as I know, this is not planned. I'm not sure, because this would have to be asked to the partners who work with this genetic modification.
Okay, yeah, perfect. It says, do you think it is feasible for construct the metabolic modeling for a complex community?
Yeah, this is actually difficult. Yes, this is a good question. I am not a modeler, but I know that this is difficult. So the modelers in our system, these are our Norwegian partners. They focus mainly on those consortia which have a defined composition. So where we do not work with enrichment cultures, for instance, and with more simple, more simple consortia. But what is possible certainly is to include, and this is also one aim, to include the more complex community somehow in a way that MECs are created, so, or is done. So these metagenome sample genomes are investigated, and they are also subjected to modeling as far as this works, or as far as this is possible.
Mm-hmm. Somebody's asking, do you compare with the production of caproic acid from lignocellulosic as a feedstock via syngas fermentation effluent?
I think I didn't get the question. If the syngas fermentation effluent is...
It says, do you compare with the production of caproic acid from lignocellulosic as a feedstock via syngas fermentation effluent?
We do not compare. So this is two totally different substrates for anaerobic fermentation. So on the one hand, you are working with organic waste, lignocellulosic waste. This is a certain waste stream that needs to be treated and can be subjected to this anaerobic fermentation. On the other hand, you have this syngas fermentation effluent, where you have this gaseous substrates. And both is absolutely possible and makes sense. And in case of the syngas fermentation effluent, you have a more defined system, because from syngas fermentation, you often obtain acetate ethanol, or both as mixtures, or more simple chemicals, then, and they can be directly subjected to the anaerobic fermentation for chain elongation. This is quite effective. In case of lignocellulose, you can only partly degrade the lignocellulose when the lignin part is almost nothing is degraded from the lignin fraction. Only hemicellulosic part is often degraded relatively well. The cellulosic part is more difficult. And then you have you have the also from the process engineering perspective, you have this solid material in your fermentation system. You have to, in the end, after removing all these chemicals from the fermentation broth, you have a residue which contains fermentation broths, all the residues from the substrate and so on. This has to be treated again, ideally in a biogas process. So, and then you receive a digestate, which can, for instance, be used as fertilizer on the field. This, all this is not possible with the syngas effluent, and also it's a totally different technology, but both ways make sense, in my opinion.
Okay, we have one here that says, considering that the product spectrum of chain elongation is typically restricted to C5 and C6 acids, which with limited C8 to C10 acids formation, what insights can you give on how to generate even longer medium chain carboxylates like C8 and C10?
Okay, it's not so easy to answer. Yes, it's usually the case that the C5, C6 are produced more, because also they are less toxic than compared to the longer chain carboxylates. And according to my experience, C10, for instance, and also C9 appear only in very low concentrations. So often from the economic perspective, this might not make sense to go that way, to really develop a process where C10 or C9 are the major or the target products. C8 is in between, and also C7. So we see, not in this sulfochem systems, but in other projects, we see quite reasonable concentrations of these products. And the question is how to produce them. Yes, this is really a good question, but not so easy to answer. So it really depends on the process conditions and steering of the system towards the MCC production and so on.
Okay. I have a final question before I close the seminar. So I just came across, you did an international like survey in your project to stakeholders that like might not be very like very well informed, because they're like, you did like different stakeholders, a massive report about your project and information that you gathered. Because I was looking at the numbers, you have like such a good response in your surveys. I just want to ask, like, how was the experience of designing these surveys where you kind of inform people about your project and then you ask kind of feedback from them? How was the experience of designing the report, the surveys, and like what was the strategy to get like so much response? Because I see that you got like somewhere like to more than 2,000 people responding to your survey. So how was that experience with that report?
Yes, this was actually quite interesting for us. This was also the first time where we did such a survey. And we did it not ourselves, but we outsourced it. We had a subcontract for, okay, a company did this for us. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there was a quite close collaboration with this company to design this survey and to ask you really the right questions and those which we were most interested in. And this company, this was quite experienced in conducting such surveys, and therefore they provided us, or they did this for us, and they had their contacts and their systems, how they do this. This was their daily business to create such surveys. And we just had this collaboration to design the questions, because they had no clue about biotechnology and all these issues, but they therefore there was it was an iterative process to really formulate the right questions and to also the answers that were provided then for the people and so on.
Yeah,
but this was really an interesting experience also for us, because we did this before. We were very happy about the bigger response also from the different countries, and all the results can be seen on the website of our project.
Yeah, I found it there. So it is great to know that there are these type of companies that do this. Like, you don't have to do all the heavy lifting, because that is a lot of work. I can see that it's a lot of work. And because in this type of project, transnational projects, they ask you to kind of go closer to different types of stakeholders. So I found that this was a really great way to do that. And you have a really like good responses. And like the difference of when you inform people about your project with the brochure, and like when people are not informed, the difference on the how it changes the answers of the people, it was really nice, incredible to see. Okay, so thank you very much to both of you, Dr. Sträuber and Dr. Gonzalez. It's 10:04, so I think I have to close the webinar right now, so everyone can go back to their daily routine. Thank you very much to our panelists, to our everyone who put a question in the Q&A and in the chat section. Unfortunately, I couldn't like answer all of them, but we are just out of time. And next week, we're going to be talking about extremophile bacteria. That's going to be a very interesting talk. Both of them, they're talking about how to exploit extremophile in order to produce chemical in a more biosustainable way. So I'll send the invitation to every one of you. And thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Sträuber and Cristina. And I'll see you in another opportunity.